Welcome to the Expert Talks. So I'm Caitlin, so as is Anant.
Hi.
So yeah, today we are going to talk about Jenkins X, which is pretty young product, right? So let's see what are the things that we are going to cover in the next 1.5 hours. So we're going to talk about a little bit of Kubernetes, and then we are going to see how we do modern product development, and what are the challenges which comes along with it. Then we are going to get into what basically Jenkins X is. We have a, then we go to a demo on creating, the entire stack. We also have a, to just give a background of how Jenkins X compares with, it's a very often asked question, Spinnaker. So, and then we have a Q&A. So, yeah. So that's about it. So quick poll, how many of you use Kubernetes in your current broad environments? Okay, how many? Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, yeah, 7. Yeah, so who is using Kubernetes? Yeah, it is. Yeah, we have it. Yeah, we have a cool. Yeah, awesome. So for the remaining people, right? So who are, so how many of you, okay, to ask the other question, right? How many of you heard about Kubernetes and know what basically is?
We know what it is.
Okay. Okay. I can also ask another question. How many of you use Docker? You are. How many don't use Docker? Okay. Cool. So just to give a quick brief on Kubernetes for the people who don't know about Kubernetes. So it's basically having, having a cluster. You have a cluster, you have a master, you have a set of nodes, you have your container, which is your deployable artifact. So you basically, Kubernetes gives you an orchestration engine, right? So it's basically a container orchestration engine where you give the container as your input, and then it assures and guarantees that particular container is going to be up and running for the parameters of the configuration that you provide, right? So you can basically compare it with what you have configuration as code or infra as code, right? So in your earlier days, or when you have, if you have worked with infra as code, right, in terms of Puppet or Chef, right? So you want a set of infra which is always there for you. You want it to be omnipotent, right? Idempotent. You want, no matter how many times you run it, you want that state to be maintained. So that same applies here in Kubernetes, where you provide the container and it guarantees you for the configuration that you would like to have, right? So if you look at so this is basically an overview of what the configuration has, Kubernetes configuration has, right? So at its core, it is your pod. So you can see the pointer, right? So at its core, it's containers which are running. So a group of containers is managed by a pod, and a pod, a bunch of pods has been exposed as a service. So you got a service, and then you got an ingress or your router, which takes the hit from outside, right, and routes it to your directory, to your pod, and to your, and then thereby to the containers. So along with it has your persistent volume, and also the storage comes with it. So that's an overview about what the YAML file or the configuration of Kubernetes, just a brief of what the config would have. And if you want to go much more deeper, so in a couple of sentences, if I have to say, so the input is your container. So basically, what do you need? You need a deployer, right? You want a deployment container, controller, and then you want a config to be maintained. So you want sort of a watcher or a monitor, which would make sure that your pods are the number of pods that you want is being maintained. So that is what the replica set controller is. And then you got a scheduler, which basically polls and checks as to whatever request is coming from outside. So kubectl is your command line tool through which you interact with your Kubernetes cluster, right? And the input, the configuration is basically your YAML file. So that's a very brief, very quick intro for the people who are new to Kubernetes. So the reason we went into Kubernetes is basically Jenkins X. That is where I'm going towards, right? Jenkins X is an opinionated platform or a CI/CD solution for Kubernetes. So before I would even go into that much more in depth, let's take a real-time example, right? So today we have an app. We are building an app, modern app. Let's assume my team name is Divergent. So for that, the customer is given a requirement of say it's an e-commerce website or a shopping cart, just to take an example, right? So the with that as an end goal, end product that I want to deliver, I also have to be able to release the new feature request that comes from the customer very often, right? At least 2 to 3 times per week. So that is something which I want to look forward to. I don't want to sit on the requirement for long and I don't want to come back after a month. These days the market moves so fast, right? And also I want to do it in a microservices all the way, right? So now you want to do you want to have your own smaller boundaries when you create an app. You don't want to write a big bloated app that we used to do in our earlier decade, where we used to do three-tier architecture, come up with the architecture, sit with the requirements. We don't want to do that anymore, right? And on top of that, you want to use Kubernetes, right? So this is my want. So this is my need, right? As a Divergent team, I want to do these things in order to deliver my e-commerce site. So that's my requirement. So what are the things that I want to do in order to accomplish, right? What should I do? Yeah, obviously, I don't have a big team right now. I'm just starting with a couple of developers. I don't have an infra guy or an ops guy, just with whatever, who are the devs are there. So we're going to take that role. So we need automation. We need automation in place for doing that with a minimum set of skilled people, developers. Then I need to do, in order to start right away with microservices, I need a pattern, right? Today I start with couple of, so I have one service which does a login, another service which does a payment, another one which does a checkout, right? And then a billing, right? So it keeps growing, right? To start with, I just need a dashboard with a list of items in my cart and then add to cart. So to start with, say login, right? I start with one service. But if I have to scale up, I need a basic pattern, right? So that is what this pattern, we would have to come up and decide with a pattern what we are going to go across in the future if you want to scale. And then I need my CI/CD pipeline for doing my test, giving the feedback to me. What I'm writing is works at the end of the day, right? And then also I need to make sure that whenever I add a new microservice, it should be simple enough for me to be integrated, right? To work as a unison, right? So once I have my first microservice ready, my login is ready, what do I do next? I need to be able to do it, promote it to higher environments, right? I may have a team, I may have one tester, but he would need his own environment. So that's where my QA and staging comes. Then I need a simple release management if I want to go all the way to prod, right? It doesn't look good if I'm good in staging. I need to go all the way to prod. So So I need to have a mechanism in place for me to be able to, you know, bump up my version and then push it to prod. That's where the release management comes in. All right, so that's what we need, right? So we identify these are the things we need to do. So how do we do it, right? So our end product is to have a Kubernetes cluster on prod, which guarantees uptime of say 99.99 whatever, right? So how do you reach there? How do I go there? So start with, yeah, basically I need to create an infra. I need to create a Kubernetes cluster, right? Then I need to set up my archetype, so let's take an example of Node.js. I need to have, or if it is a Spring Boot, I need to start with an archetype, basically a template. Then set up my CI/CD, which is Jenkins, configure my pipelines, right? Release management via pipelines. Then I need to go ahead and set up my jobs to spin up new environments if I have to create right from code, say Terraform or Chef or Puppet. Then I need to also be able to destroy them if I'm not using it, right? For my preview or dev environments. Then I have to decide whether it has to be based on a particular pull request. So certain pull requests may have its own needs, right? That feature may be not be in line with what we have in master. So I would need a separate environment for that. Then finally, I need to set up a webhooks, right? So it should be automated. It should be integrated into my source control workflow. So if I have to do, and we still have, I may have missed out many more things. So all these things looks like a lot of, for me, it looks like it's not, I can't be doing it within a day or so, right? Certainly need sort of thinking to come up with what are the basic structure to be there, to have all my environments and be in prod. Okay, how much time does it take? So I need to give an estimate to my client, right? Customer, say, saying, give me my first demo. Give me an estimate, right? So I'm just listing you guys. So 1 week, can I come? So 1 month? Shall you do it in 1 month? So I got just two devs and one, say, QA. Just three guys and one BA. So these people, I mean, so it's a basic project from scratch, right? So no idea. So we have no idea how much it takes, right? Maybe 2 months. It may take. All right. So let's do it in an hour, right? What's that? Yeah, it is on. Okay, so we need it in an hour. So that's where Jenkins X comes in, right? Yeah, so we can do all these in an hour. That is Jenkins X for you. It's an opinionated set of whatever we saw, how to do it, all built in and out of box, right? That's where, so how does it do it? So when I say all in a box, out of box, I mean all the way to prod, right? So it gives you all the environments, it provides you those mechanisms, the best practices to go through it. So how does it do it? So number one is to figure out what are the things that is needed for me to push to Kubernetes all the way, right? I need set of tools, right? So some of the tools that Jenkins X provides out of box is Helm. So these are the tools. So to give a brief about, how many of you have heard these names? Helm, Scaffold, Monocular. Okay, so let me give a small brief. So Helm is something similar to Nexus, but in terms of Kubernetes, it is your package manager for packaging your Kubernetes configurations. Scaffold is something which gives you the enough workflow. Yes, but yeah, Helm is on the higher level, which directly talks to your deployment manager I just showed you within Kubernetes, right? So it interacts with your Kubernetes cluster and then manages in that level. So it's much more closer to Kubernetes. Scaffold is something which gives you the orchestration the whole orchestration around it. And case sync is your it's something where if you, so you have your own local dev code, right? So you make a change and you want to immediately see your change in Kubernetes environment or product. So that's where it gives you the flexibility. If you want to do a ad hoc environment or a preview environment, it pushes the code right away and then you can see the change immediately. And monocular is something where it's an UI for managing your Helm charts. So Helm is your, it's like an access, and charts are your artifact, which is like your jar files, right? So you can compare jar files with charts within Kubernetes jargon. So monocular gives you a nice UI for exploring those. It's like your UI for browsing through the charts. Nexus is something which we all know. Concos is your CI, yeah.
CI,
yeah.
So how are we doing compared to Jenkins?
Yeah, I'm coming to that. So yeah, all of them are configured and optimized for Kubernetes out of the box. So it also automates CI/CD for your applications on Kubernetes. It provides you, so when I say it, it's all about Jenkins X, not the Kubernetes. Jenkins X provides you also an internal repo. If you're not managing via Docker app, you can have a Docker registry within it. It also provides you a Helm chart repo. And then you got your pipelines. So when I say the pipeline, you have Jenkins within Jenkins X as well. So you get out of box Jenkins for managing that, starting from checking out, building, packaging, pushing to Docker. So that part is managed by CI, which is Jenkins. So we have Jenkins wrapped within Jenkins X. So now this is, uses GitOps, right? So GitOps is, how many of you heard GitOps? So you got DevOps, you got DevSecOps, GitOps. So this is a latest trend where you don't want to layer your workflow, developer workflow, right? So what do we have currently, which is interacting on a daily basis with the developers? Git, right? Currently, most of the people, how many of you don't use Git? Anyone in here doesn't use Git? Everybody, right? So Git is something which we interact on a daily basis. So when we are using Git, so instead of having our own set of workflow for how we check in the code, how we do the releases, and how do we do deployment, right? So we are basically merging both the workflows, right? So here we are talking about build, deploy, then test, build, test, deploy, basically, right? So we are merging these two workflow, the release workflow with your developer workflow, right? So that is where GitOps is about. It basically gives you an agile workflow for you to use the orchestration all the way to take it to prod. So basically you have your testing, staging, and production. So when I say test, staging, production, we use Git tags. So basically creating a Git tag would give me the ability to go promote my environment from staging to prod. And doing a pull request would automatically trigger. So basically we have our Git webhooks plugged in as part of Jenkins, right? So that would automatically trigger a CI build and take it all the way to the next environment, higher environment, right? So feedback all the way. So like, also Jenkins X provided you a nicer way to document the changes that you're doing, right? So let's say I have my product in staging, I have my artifact in staging, I have it ready. I have tagged my Docker image, but I want to take that and put it in prod, right? What do I do? So I go and do a deploy. Or in Kubernetes terms, I say kubectl, and then provide all my configuration, and I give the tag name, right? the tag name for the Docker image to be pushed. So all these have to be done manually. So rather than doing that, Jenkins X provides you the ability to just promote it, right? You just have a keyword which is promote and target the environment. It does the commenting and it does the git commit and does a comment on what is the version or the tag, and then it pushes, does the rest of the job for you. So that's what the last point means. So we'll see much more when we do when Pal does a complete demo. All right, I think it's time. Enough of talk, and let's get into demo.
Yeah, thanks. So this is a lot of steps or tasks we need to execute. Like that's what we identified, right? As well as it takes time. If we are setting up CI/CD pipeline, when do we start with the business logic, like business actual thing, what customer has paid us, right? Or we are getting paid for, right? That is very important, right? Let's get started. So what do we need to get started with Jenkins X, right? We need a environment or a cloud provider, identify a cloud provider. It might be a AWS or a Azure or Google, identify it, create an account. I guess most of the cloud provider, if you want to try out, they provide with a free account as well for a period. You can give it a shot. Next, you need Jenkins X, all right? Install it on our system, okay? Either if you are using Mac, use Brew, or if you are using Linux, use Curl. Other platforms, there are options. So Jenkins JX, it is a command line tool. You can just download and put it in your bin. It is executable. Yeah. Then the first step, I guess, what we have identified is we need to create a cluster to get started with, right? Identify, build a cluster of Kubernetes cluster. For the demo, I won't be doing it here. I'll just use, because the cluster creation takes some time. I don't want to wait for that.
Takes around 45 minutes.
Yes.
It's quite some time.
Okay, this is the first command what we'll execute. How to increase the font?
Can you spectacle to probably zoom?
No, I cannot, I guess.
So this is only the video, right? So video, when you go into the demo, we can zoom there.
Yeah. Okay. So I just ran a command. JX create cluster. This is a standard OAuth flow for Google. What it started asking, it asks for the project. So Google Cloud, it wraps everything into a project. So I said Jenkins X project, then which zone of Google you want to create the cluster. Say Asia, then what are the type of the machine. So every pod or the node is an instance by itself, right? If you have spinned up a Kubernetes cluster in Google or anywhere, so it creates a node. That you need to give the type of node or the standard, like whether it is a 2 CPU or a 4 CPU. You need to identify that.
Any GK guys? Anyone in Google Cloud?
One? Most of us.
AWS?
AWS? Okay. So, yeah, for a demo, I'll be using GK. Sorry.
Yeah, they're using GK.
Yeah. And for cluster, you need to identify how many nodes you have, right? Minimum number of nodes and maximum, so that it can scale on the need basis.
Have you done that already in the configuration?
Yes. Yeah. No, it is actually asking. So when you execute the command, thing, yes, it is interactive.
The defaults are tuned to, you know, optimized for you.
Yes.
So you can just keep going.
Yeah. Or else, if you want to convert everything as a command line, you can pass it as an arg. So, for take example, I have named my cluster as divergent. So, minus n, I pass the name, it creates the cluster with that name. Right. If you want to label your cluster as well, you can go ahead and do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it has figured out and set up a tiller.
So now what it's doing is it's creating the help.
Yeah. And configuring it.
Yeah.
For us. And it also needs a ingress controller, right? So yeah, you will be spinning up a lot of services. You want it to be exposed. So that means you need a ingress control. So one of the things what he was I'm mentioning is you need something which controls the traffic. So what it happens is, as part of the ingress, it creates kind of a load balancer for you, okay, and it exposes it. And say I'll say yes and create it in the kube system namespace. And it has created the controller and it has assigned the IP for me as well. So what Jenkins X does is it assigns, picks up the IP and it tries to use the nip.io domain, that is a wildcard DNS. And if you want to set up a wildcard DNS by yourself, either in AWS or Google, any provider, you can very well do that. But for the demo, what I'll do is I'll create a CNAME in Google provider which points to the nip.io, so that I need not have to worry about creating the wildcard DNS. I'll say map my nip.io domain to akpal.in, that is a test site what I have picked. I'll copy the nip.io, go to Kubernetes. This is the cluster that it has created.
It's basically your Route 53 records, right?
Yes.
It's just mapping it to this.
This is the load balancer that it has created. And if you see the IP and if you compare it with the nip.io IP, it's a video.
Okay, so.
Yeah. The IPs will match, right? I'll say anything with star, just forward it to my nip.io domain so that on top of the star will get automatically forwarded. All done, I'll say go, enter. So it will ask, do you want to create a CI/CD pipeline? So it is, yeah, most of us will say yes, but if at all you want to skip these steps. So what it has done is it has created the initial values. So what it does is, for Jenkins X comes with the defaults, right? If you want to override for certain environments, so you can create a repo by yourself and point it to it. So that's exactly it was asking, like, do you want to clone something or you already have? There are certain arguments for Google we can override, for AWS you can override if you want to override it, otherwise it will just take the defaults. Those are nothing but the extra values. If you go to the Jenkins X repo or organization in GitHub and go to the cloud environments, you can go through that repo and figure out how it actually overrides things. And yes, it is updating.
So this is creating a cluster, is it cross environments or only environments you create?
It creates one cluster.
For everything?
Yes. It's normally most of the times we control environments based on namespace. Namespace kind of make sure you don't do cross communication.
Cross.
Yes.
So when you create the application, you get the remaining environments. Yes. The other namespaces are created.
So later.
Yes. So if you see, it has just created all the services and deployments. So if you remember the when Faitlin was explaining the diagram, right, there was a deployment, there was service, like, so those are the more of configuration you have to do. Either you do via a common YAML, that is ks.yaml, or you can do it via Helm templates, right? In templates you define, okay, deployment.yaml, then service.yaml, so you can split it across. So everything is an object. That's how the Kubernetes configuration works. So if it is one YAML, you split it by saying that what is the type of the configuration it is. You see, what it has done is it has created a chart museum pod for me, that is where you host your charts. Then Docker registry, it has created Docker registry by itself. If at all you don't want to use the registry which comes with the Jenkins X, you can always, when you create a cluster, you can say, okay, I want to point to my Docker Hub, I'm already paying for it, I want to use it. Or you want to use ECR, you can use it. Alright. And it has created a MongoDB just to manage your status, all those things, and your molecular UI, where you can see the Helm charts. And of course, Nexus.
So it also creates a backend compute instances for MongoDBs automatically.
Yes.
Expensive.
Yes. So these are all my deployments, and it also creates a couple of cron jobs as well, just to make sure you are cleaning up instances, tracking activities. All those things are very necessary. Like, this is more of a operational overhead you are trying to avoid. So it another nice thing what it gives is you can track all the activities via your shell itself. You need not have to go to the UI, right? So you can just say JX get activities minus W. It will just watch and run the commands for you. At the end of the creation of the cluster, what it also does is by default it creates two environments for us, right? One is staging, which is configured to auto promote. What does auto promote means? Whenever you merge something to the master or selected branch, it will auto promote to the staging environment, as well as it gives another environment called production, okay, which you can do manually, or if you can configure it to say do it automatic as well.
Is there a branch called production?
No, it doesn't. It actually works on the master. If you want, you can override it and say, okay, whenever something happens on master, production, promote it to production. So a lot of the teams I have seen, they have master branch which automatically promotes to production, and they have a release branch or a slash production branch, whatever the name is. So basically, it is a final branch. When you merge it, it gets promoted to production.
So yes. Pre-configured to target for staging, and you get production as a separate configuration, right? So separate repo.
Yes. Yeah. So I'll just walk you through the repo as well. Okay. So if you see, it has created two repos. One is a divergent, and other one is a staging. Other one is a production. Okay. What you have in the repos, it is the basic configurations, right? You go to env and you say requirements. It will say, okay, deploy my Expose controller, and also deploy, this is one of the app I had created, node app for this version, and use this repository. This is nothing but your chart museum repository.
So this tells you what is the latest version of configuration.
What is the latest version of the app which is getting deployed? So if you see the node app, the version which is in staging is 0.02. Okay, so if
before deployment, is it saying that it's
This happens via import, which is the next step. This I had created before. If you see production, I have not promoted the node app to production. You don't have that, right? Unless you commit something. This is where the GitOps, you know, actually in the repo itself, like what is my version, which environment runs on which version, right?
This he created like 7 hours.
Yeah. So just to avoid. So these two repos.
Oh, this is created by you or Jenkins?
This is created by the one command. Okay. When we say Jenkins create cluster minus GKE and GKE minus name, when you give, right? All these things it does it
just
for.
Creates it in the okay.
Yes. Okay, yeah. You can configure it for others also. So since my local is configured for GitHub, it has picked up GitHub. Yes. Yeah. Currently Jenkins supports GitHub, Bitbucket, and GitLab. Okay, these are deep integration. What does deep integration means? This works via webhooks, APIs. Okay, if at all you have your own server, you can very well do that, but it won't give as good as integration. But they are working on it. The next part is, it has also spinned up Jenkins for me. Okay. The other nice thing what it does is, so take example, if you are trying to use across the organization and you want to share the across the team, within teams, you within project you will have multiple teams, right? It gives a nice structure for you. You can say, okay, belongs to, and within that you can have your own folders. This is more of enclosing, making sure that, okay, you are in the right directory, all those things. Okay, so yeah, That is our first thing. Yeah, we have environment ready now. So what is the next what we can do? Okay, next thing is either you want to create a new app or work on the existing. So most of the times, I guess you guys are trying to move into Kubernetes, right? So that means you have already an app which is working. You might have Docker, you might have a pipeline ready, but what it needs to take to production in Kubernetes is either you can just do JX import, or if you are starting from scratch, so in the example what Petling was mentioning, the e-commerce website where a team is booting up, it's a greenfield project. That time you just say JX create quick start. What actually create quick start does is it will figure out the templates. I'll go with the samples. So what it does is you can point it to a organization in your GitHub. It might be your user profile, or it might be a organization profile by itself, right? And you can say this is a pattern. Anything which matches this pattern is my template for my projects. Okay. So what internally Jenkins X uses is draft. Draft is more of initialization. It identifies what type of the project it is, then creates a Docker file for you. It's one which is open source by Azure. And templates. These are simple templates, like which will have a replace underscore me kind of a pattern. For demo, let us assume that I want to create a Node app. Okay.
Any Go developers here? Golang.
Sorry, I'll go with.
So when you said templates, it's basically Go templates.
This is actually a project template. So if you see, if at all, I guess after the talk, I'll walk you through the repo as well. If you go to the repo, you can see that all these are projects. These are repositories in that the Jenkins Quickstart organization. You have Android, ASP, Golang.
So the box,
this, yeah, this is there. There we go. Or the, yes, you can override this as well, okay. Right? What they recommend is, if at all you have contributed, like take example, if somebody wants to work on Elixir and they has created a template, they would like to contribute back to the community, right? So you can contribute to that organization.
Yeah, so Java is not there.
It is there. So Java is nothing but
Spring Boot is there.
Yeah, Spring Boot. Yeah, you have Spring Boot, Rust, React. So for this, I'll go with say Node, HTTP. Okay. Let's see. Sample app. And it'll ask, do you want to create this? So what I have done is I have created this, ran this command locally, right? So as part of the project, I want a repo to be created for me, right? That's exactly it is asking.
Are you able to see the fonts?
Actually, zoom a little bit.
That's
okay. So you want to initialize Git, yes?
Yes.
That's the name. Okay. Then commit, if you want to override the commit. I'll just go with the standard ones. And it is actually creating the repo in GitHub. Alright.
The Wi-Fi is good.
Yeah, hopefully.
So what it does is that it uses the
So what it has identified is I have part of multiple organization, right? So it asks, okay, where you want to create it as well. So I'll say there, and this is the repository name, creating the repo. Right. Okay, it has created the repo, and also it has registered the webhook as well. So Jenkins works, the Jenkins water, Jenkins X has been done, works based on webhooks. So it has registered webhooks saying that, okay, any changes that happens, push it to this endpoint. Okay. Yeah. Now, I guess in the video I was mentioning about the activities, right? So let us see what happens in the activities. So it has identified the master. There is a master, there is a new app that got created and it started running. Okay. So if you see, you can ignore, these are the previous ones what I was doing. The every environment when you spin up, it shows the complete job details for you here as well. Alright. And just now I committed master, so it has started running a job for master. So it is in checkout source, which is pending, and okay, checkout source has succeeded. It is trying to push the snapshot. It is trying to release. Okay. Now let us parallelly, it will take a couple of minutes, so it needs to initialize the Docker containers, pods, then slaves in the Jenkins. This is a repo, right? This is your code. The code does, code belongs to your other.
If you see, it's promoting, it's a staging.
This Jenkins X uses Jenkins, right? So Jenkins internally uses pods rather than you need to have master slaves, right? It controls via master slaves.
Okay. So it's creating pods to run your build.
Yes, exactly. So it is creating pods to run the build. And let's see what it contains, right? So it has created something for me. I would like to know what it contains, what it has, all right? First, the code, actual code, what it has. It's just simple, just returns the index.html. Next is...
This comes from your templates.
Yes, this comes from templates. So take example, you using Node.js and you want to make sure certain libraries you are using across, like certain like take a passport, you want to use it across your microservices. You can initialize all those things here. Okay. And it has created a Docker file for me, which is simple. Again, you can override it based on your requirements. If you have a custom repo where you have already hosted your Docker images and you want all your new services to be initialized with those rather than the out of box which comes. And this is your Jenkins file. So these are based on templates. So it just replaced the org as Anant Pal and app name as sample app. It's initialized chart museum credentials. Yeah, you can want to modify, you can go ahead and modify. So Jenkins also provides add-ons, right? Like if you want to have a Grafana integrated, all those things you can very well do it. And if you want to modify Jenkins X file, you can. Then it provides scaffold. Okay, scaffold, as Fethlin was mentioning, it's more of a development tool. What it does is whenever code changes, if you monitor up for a code, whenever it changes, it redeploys to your pods. Right? This recently it was released by Google. And it says, okay, use this helm with these details. And the final important one is the charts. It has created two. The first one is the template part. It has a deployment YAML, standard charts. Okay. So, yeah, these are details, I guess. We have worked on the YAML file, Kubernetes YAML file. This exact same, but it is more templatized. That's the thing. And this is a service. You define, okay, who needs to manage, how to run, what is the version, all those details. And these values will be overridden in your preview environment. When preview environment, so normally charts, so people control the environment specific data, right? What value, what is the replica set, what is the environment value, all those things you can control it here. That's exactly we'll be doing. So what it needs to do after helm, what is the post to install, all those things.
So values.yaml is your actual parameters.
Okay. So we have charts and that's it. This is all it generates, right? And of course you can customize it. Like if you want certain shell scripts to be part of every repo, yeah, you can very well do it. and it has run the job and it has also deployed it to my staging. Now what it has done to promote it, what steps it has taken to promote it to staging, let us go through it. So what has happened is when the sample app got created, it ran the job for itself in the master. As part of that, it also wants to make sure the all my charts, YAML, all those things are valid, right? It has done that. And it has actually created a PR in my staging environment. Okay, so sample lab 0.0.1. And it has also merged the PR. Because the reason it has merged is you have marked staging environment as a auto promotion environment. That's the one of the reason it has merged the PRs, right?
Yeah.
And it has added a new entry saying that, okay, you need to do a deploy a sample app with this version from the start PC, right? And yeah, so all this in seconds. So if you can just go through it, the steps, right? So there's the master app. So it started here. Started pushing the snapshot, promote to environments. It identified, okay, staging is the auto promotion environment. Then created the PR for you and started running validation. So most of the times, this is a common practice I was in, like it is a YAML file. People don't put write tabs or give attributes which are not identified Kubernetes, and we merge it. And when it tries to promote it, it fails, right? Here it tries to validate it once, right? So that's exactly, it ran the job for the divergent staging itself, right? And yes, once everything goes to merge, and this is the URL. Yeah?
Yeah.
This is a staging environment. So if you see the namespace, right, this is the app and staging.
So is that also a convention or is something?
It by default appends the name and the environment name. So when you create an environment, you need to give a namespace or the name to it, right? By default, this is created by Jenkins, so it has given JX staging.
So you can actually override that with our organization.
Yes, and you can customize. So if you want to say, okay, I want certain environments should use different domains altogether, not subdomain. Very well, you can go ahead and do that. So if you say JX create environment, it asks all those questions again, right?
So can you see all this in the Jenkins
repo? Yes. Yeah. So if you see the Jenkins, has run master, has run it just now, like sometime back. And like if you see the commit, says promote sample app to version 0.
So
it
actually run git commit triggered.
Yes, it's webhook. So yeah, that part, yes. Here it is. This is the pull request we just merged, right? So these are branches. It works mostly on the pull request. Okay. So let us do something, right? Like yeah, we are done with the staging. What to do to promote it to production, right? Then that will be the next step. So before that, let us try to update a app and see how the workflow works, right? So what I'll do is, I'll go to the folder. Okay, I'll create a new branch. New feature. Okay. And I'll just edit the HTML, right? Let's say hello node instead of that. Hello from Jenkins X. Save it. I'll add speed. Commit. Update text. I'll just push it.
Okay.
Yeah, this is a feature branch. Okay. Now when I go to repo sample app, it should ask for me, okay. Yeah, I want to create a PR. Right. Say it. I'll keep the title like this. Create pull request. What happens now is your workflow triggers. It wants to validate, right? Now whatever the things what we have committed should not break the existing ones. Or if you have added new tests, it should validate all those things. That's exactly the pipeline runs. The cycle has started happening. So it has started running the job for it, right? And the same thing you can even monitor in the CLI as well, right? You do not have to switch, right? If you are working on the shell or you are a Vim or a Emacs fan, yeah, everything is there at your disposal. And if you are an IDE fan, you have plugin which does this for you. Yeah, it doesn't matter anymore. Just wanted to open it. And it has created all these are the jobs actually. These are the folders in your Jenkins. And it gives you the tree. And it is green. And it is actually red.
You see the logs?
It's like an entire UI.
And actually, you can even see
the stages.
Yeah, it has a IntelliJ plugin as well, but not as mature as this one. Okay.
And it shows all PR.
Yes. And it's run the job for me, and everything is fine. And what it has done, it has commented. Only thing is, it has commented on behalf of me because I had given my API token as when I configured my GitHub, and it has created a preview environment for me.
Sorry, what's that?
This is a preview environment. Every PR, when you create, it creates a preview environment. This is exactly the decision making, right? You need not have to decide for this PR, should I create or not? After using it, should I destroy it or not? All those decision making is out of your scope altogether. You just need to think about coding. That's it. Yeah.
But if I keep my PR open for a long time,
this will be okay. Yes. And basically, you will consume your resources, right? So you will have multiple pods running and multiple nodes. So you have only selected amount of nodes. Nodes will get consumed, and other things will start getting impacted. Right? If you want to see the difference, this is the staging environment, which is hello node from Jenkins X. And it is hello from Jenkins. All this in like one command, that is the new command we need to learn, and remaining branch creation, everything is standard practice what we follow. So yeah, you can, once you merge the PR, that environment of course will get destroyed, right? What is the next part? Right, I say I want to release it, what I need to do before that. So when it spinned up the Jenkins X, right, when you created the cluster, it also created the monocular UI, right? This is the UI what it has created, right? And it has two charts already, right? One is node app, which is existing one, and node app has reached multiple times. So it has 0.0.1 and 0.0.2. Those are the two releases and versions. Comes the new sample app again. Okay. and how actually what happens, how it controls is based on your releases. So, it has actually created the releases for you. This is it, artifacts. If you want to do additional things, of course you can do that as part of your Jenkins pipeline. And if you want to add certain change log, yeah, this is normal Git flow. The next part, that is, yeah, we are done with this, how to promote it. As simple as that, it is belongs to any environment. You need to say, if I want to promote sample app, so JX promote, sample app, environment name, if it's a production, production, then what is the version? Version is nothing but your Git tag version. So there is, now your charts are versioned the same way, your Git tags are versioned the same way. So you have one version you are tracking now, right? And your repo says which version is in which stage. So if you have create a new environment, you can just configure it saying that for this environment, use this version of the app. Yes, you can bump it as well. It follows him. Yes, that's exactly happened, right? So take example, the other app.
Okay.
So
can you do like a major version from something?
Yes, that you need to do manually. Yes, so you need to update your conf and push it, then it will start bumping on that. Okay, so all these, both the releases. Yes, it is, yeah, it, you can do all those things via Kubernetes, right? You can move that namespace out and control it as well.
Let's say this command is run.
You can do, I have not explored that part yet. Yes, it uses RBAC, the role-based control of Kubernetes itself. Yes, so you have, if you don't give access to that namespace for the things, of course, these commands
so
will
it's
fail.
Not using Jenkins user, it's
yes,
using
yes,
Jenkins.
Yes. Yeah. What next?
Tools.
Yeah. So, I guess most of us have done that or I have mentioned. Yeah, it works in local, but I don't know what is happening in.
That's a typical developer jargon, right?
Oh.
Yeah. It so works in my local. It should work in Prague, right?
Yeah.
That's. So yeah, I have my change locally, and I need that in immediately in Prague, right? So I want to check it out in my preview environment. So that's a one-liner. So I make the change in my Word and make my change. Let's do that. So let's. I want to make a change in my index.html. In our case, then I should see that updated right away in my current
Jenkins
project. Where are we?
Need to go back.
So let's make the change in wrap. Yeah, first let's create the, so what does this command does is that JX sync does is that it uses an internal tool which is called ksync, which I just spoke about it. So it downloads that, you know, automates that tooling aspect is taken care in the background, and then we go ahead and create our dev pod, which is our own private shell or our node. And we get direct root access to that shell. So we can do whatever we want to do within that shell.
Which is your dev pod will be the exact replica of your preview environments.
Yeah.
Alright. So this is where all changes up. What you do, you can actually see, okay, in the preview environment how it looks.
So what it does currently is that it basically is streaming my existing code, which is the node app. So this is getting streamed into my Jenkins X environment toolchain, and then once I create my next command, which is the create dev pod, so that streamed code will be available within my newly created node. So let's do the other one. Are you in the right folder? So we need to select which lang we are going to create. So this is basically your infra or the single pod or single environment, single node environment.
Which just belongs to you. You cannot, you need not have to share it.
Which is prepared against the tool that we just, or language which we just chose, right? So out of box support is available. So where is our other terminal? First one? Yeah. So we got it synced. So what we did, where are we, slash what?
Yeah.
Node app. So we should be in the right tab before we run the command. So that's a difference. So it's using, utilizing the existing created pod. Then now when we say ls, so whatever we had in that folder got imported into this new pod, new node. Now, so now I have this ready. I just run this command. The next part is start the watcher, right? So this watcher is going to look for your code changes, keeps looking, and then it's update, going to push it, update it. So I'm going to start the watcher. This is ready. So now I go ahead and change, make the change, the environment. So let's look at the environment. What is the environment that we have?
JX get. Just do a JX get.
Yeah, so JX get environments.
Applications.
Apps. So these are my applications.
Yeah, this is where you can identify what are the applications.
Yeah. So I'm currently looking at node app. So take that.
Edit.
Other. Yeah.
You picked up the staging.
Okay. So sample app. This one, right? Yeah, so it basically gave me another endpoint or service URL. So this is my current environment where the dev pod is created, right? So now I go ahead and change, make the change in my local and local code. So both my laptop code as well as the node, the environment code, they both are syncing as we speak. So I'm saying hello. So devs, experts. So just make a save. Did I save it? In the right. Yeah. So basically, just pushed it all the way to my right, so it identified one is, it identified the right cluster and also it identified the pod and the number of replica that we may have n number of replicas, right? So that it updated all of them just for us. So this is only happening in our dev pod, right?
So does it also work in Java?
Yeah.
It's, what it does is it destroys your container and recreates it. That's
how the scaffold
works. So you can see that these are the supported environments. Go is there.
Sorry.
Okay.
Yes. Yep. Yeah. It is. It's more of a. We are back to the VDI work.
And what if I have some functionality like that? So I did a feedback.
You can very well do it. It depends on, you can say as part of your Docker image, you can run the test, initiate it, and point it to it. Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
So actually, the investment on your local box can be reduced, right? You need not have to have a 16 GB, like 32 GB system, right? So assume that we have like 16, 18 microservices running all those in local. You need a AWS instance or something. Not necessarily, right? So if you are working on one thing, you can have one pod. It can be few instances, right? You can say my node size is of 16 GB, and in that you can run multiple pods. Yeah, you can delete the pods.
So you go ahead and just say JX destroy. So right now we have both.
Just a little bit of pop. No, it will take some time.
Take some time?
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah, so the activity would show what's happening right now, right? All right. So.
Yes.
Yep. So it's basically a file streamer. So
it is in Node you have a watcher, right? So here it uses, if you open the watch.sh. Yes. In the IDE again. Watch.sh. So it uses the node module watch CLI. You can configure like. Yes, you can configure that. It is under your control. You can say okay, every 5 minutes run the job, or on save run the job. It's more of when you trigger that command. Did that answer?
So that magic of happens.
Yes. Of course, scaffold also gives the monitoring one. Not using it.
So these are like putting together a tool chain which gives you the power to do that, right? So it's basically scaffold, it's your node module, and on top of that it's all wrapped in a nice chocolate wrapper, right, for you to consume.
Yes, especially for the Jenkins X, right?
Yeah.
The problem is Minikube, you need to have a really good system, right? Otherwise
Yeah.
If you are able to get it up, and challenge is mine. I'm work on 8 GB machine, so no way.
Cool. So let's move on to the next slide. Can you see the image? Is it clear? Are we in present mode?
Yeah.
Do we have a zoom inside this guy?
Now then zoom it.
No. That's fine.
Sorry.
Wow. You just did something. Yeah. Cool. Yeah. So this is about the whole workflow that we just did. So this actually maps the tools which are helping us on each of our milestones, right? Each of our workflow. So it's. We start our environment with JX create spring. So in our case, we did a JX create node.js. So the underlying tool which helps us to do is that it's draft. So you may not be able to see, but it's draft. So draft gives you the same archetype function, the templating for the entire Kubernetes configuration. Then once you push it, you got Helm helping you. to build your scaffold, you have to build and then push it all the way into your targeted namespaces, right? The ones which you see on top. So the last environment we saw is preview. Then it's your staging and prod. So Helm helps you to push and deploy your charts. Once you have your pull request done, once you merge it to your to your master, then it gets promoted automatically to your staging environment. That's a next step. You also have the other command, which is JX open app, which basically opens your targeted URL. In our case, it is a staging prod dot your domain name, right? So, and the registry that you see here is a Docker registry and a chart museum. So, all the while, this is going to be your core driving factor. Your builds are going to be pulled from here, from your Docker registry, and your charts are going to be pulled from your chart museum. Chart museum, you can just compare it with what your Nexus or Artifactory, right? So you can just draw parallels for that. And finally, we saw the JX promote prod command. So that's your single line command, which is a manual gate. So a person basically manually does it for you. Cool. So that's a quick recap of what we did, how we created a cluster, we created a app, a quick start. You can either use a quick start or target, you can configure your command line to have fully overridden parameters, and then we modified the app and then tested it in preview and dynamic environment. Also, we did a local, and then we tested it. We were able to see the change directly, right?
And then if you don't want to remember the commands, there are plugins for, I guess, Visual Code. There is a plugin as well as IntelliJ, which will say. Use step four. It will start syncing. You need not have to run all those commands from the command.
Yeah. And finally, it is the promoter. We promoted the app. So with just the tag versioning and the targeted environment, we'll be able to promote. So that's about the recap. I just want to take a few minutes. How many of you used, I think I asked the question, right? Spinnaker? No one here? What the name Spinnaker?
How many of you know?
Heard about Spinnaker? One, two? Just now, is it? Okay, so Spinnaker is there for quite a while, past around more than 2 years. But Spinnaker, to put it in a single word, Spinnaker is a multi-cloud deployment manager with support for multiple deployment strategies, specifically for Kubernetes, right? Here we are only talking about Kubernetes. We have not explored the in-depth of Kubernetes, what are the different ways we can push. We are able to do a deploy using Helm deploy, right? But we have not explored how we can take down, if I have a live environment today and I want to push a change, and I have users on the road, they could get impacted by my change. How do I do it? So I just want to target a particular region, or I want to do a blue-green deployment, or I want to do a canary, right? So, or I just want to choose a percentage of users to target. So all those deployment strategies are inbuilt into Spinnaker, right? Basically, Spinnaker is not a CI server, but it takes from where you bake and give an artifact, right? So the input for Spinnaker is the Docker image or your entire scaffold configuration, right? So from there, it takes all the way to a prod, and it gives you the ability to turn off and turn on your clusters and the configuration that you have live, right? So the UI support is really good in terms of what we can do and accomplish within your live prod environment. We are talking about live prod environment. It's not about the whole CI pipeline, but focusing on the deployment strategy. So that is where Spinnaker shows its strength. Jenkins X doesn't yet has that capability, but we can probably look at the roadmap. of, you know, of choosing a region or choosing a canary build strategy, deployment strategy. Yeah. So Spinnaker provides you a, it's like a power user or a new user can directly go and use the UI. And we can all, we can do that everything via config. Via config you can do.
So basically he's talking about the UI part basically. If you are new, what do you need to do? You need to
not only that,
commands you need to remember, right?
So not only that, you will have to change multiple places and how you want to impact it. So how are you going to deploy it, right? So you have to do a manual helm deploy. You have to type it out, kubectl, you have to push it. So that can be avoided with a click of a button. So the UI support is really good. So that's what I'm trying to share, right? So Jenkins X is like doubling up with both the CI server as well as you have a deployment manager built in. So it's a wrapper on top of both, right? And Jenkins X, it's actually giving you a tool chain which is like underlined. So it's just stitching together all those tools to give you a nice workflow and gives you a GitOps model of doing things around. And it doesn't directly touch the Kubernetes running configuration, right? Yeah, so that's all we have for the day.
And if you are interested in the Jenkins X, what is the roadmap?
Yeah, currently this, we have DigitalOcean and EKS on the pipeline.
Okay.
EKS is the Elastic Kubernetes Service.
Let's encrypt Argo. All these are in progress. It has also a concept of add-ons, right? So it already gives a support for Anchor. So if you want to do a security test for your Docker images, you can very well install and do it. Yeah. And print. Yeah. Yes. 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 Jenkins X file is there. Right? You can very well. Do you have a Jenkins X file available? Yeah, Jenkins file is already available for you. Right. Once you create an app, you can very well go and modify.
I understand. Right. Thanks, man.
Yep.
That's it, guys.
Yep. So.
Q.
That's it. Thank you.